ahead of the curve. It's the John Batchelor Show on 77 WABC.
John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show. Time Machine, December 1990, Germany. Two generals, one named Schwarzkopf, one named Franks. The order, take the Seven Corps to Saudi Arabia, attack the Republican Guard, and destroy it. The battle to free Kuwait. Douglas MacGregor's Warrior's Rage, the Great Tank Battle of 73 Easting. Doug, congratulations and good evening. Who is Franks, and who is Schwarzkopf, and that order that stood in December? What was the order?
Well, first, thanks, John, for inviting me to your program. I appreciate it very much. In December 1990, General Franks had been given access to more forces, both at sea and on land, as well as more air forces. Effectively, the President of the United States had said, you can have whatever you want, and he asked for the 7th United States Corps, which was an armored force sitting in northern Bavaria that had been designed, obviously, for war in Central Europe against the Soviet armed forces. It was a corps of about 110,000 men, contained over 1,000 tanks, more than 1,100 or 1,200 armored fighting vehicles with 25-millimeter cannon and tow missiles that we call Bradleys, untold numbers of artillery cannon, rockets, and so forth. When this force was made available to Franks, Franks did not waste time. He met with his senior commanders, including General Frederick M. Franks, who at the time was the 7th Corps commander in Germany. And in this particular forum, which included commanders of other units that would be fighting alongside the 7th Corps and in the 7th Corps, he made it very clear that the mission of the 7th United States Corps, this huge force of over 1,000 tanks and thousands of artillery pieces and so forth, would be to attack across southern Iraq, along the border with Kuwait, deep into Iraq, virtually in the direction of the Euphrates River, to find, ultimately destroy, the Iraqi Republican Guard Corps. Now, the Republican Guard Corps numbered about 80,000 men. It had over 1,000 tanks in it. These were tanks of Soviet manufacture, but of course they were manufactured for export, so they were not exactly what the Soviet groups of forces in Europe had, but they were very battle-worthy T-72s for the most part, along with BMPs, which is an armored fighting vehicle with a 30-millimeter cannon on it, and a host of other armored fighting vehicles, and again, large quantities of artillery. And this force was stationed deep behind the Iraqi forces in Kuwait, designed to operate as potentially a mobile reserve force. And it was important because it was extremely well-equipped, very well-paid, and considered to be, from an ideological standpoint, absolutely loyal to Saddam Hussein and the Ba'athist regime that he presided over.
Douglas MacGregor, Colonel, U.S. Army retired, a decorated combat veteran. He's a PhD in international relations from the University of Virginia. And we are discussing the events of December 1990 and January 1991. And why those are profound is that that Iraq and what happened in the battle in February has colored the intervening 19 years, has changed American history, has rendered the Middle East the now present tangle of alliances, and perhaps has permitted Iran to rise as the regional hegemon, a nuclear power that threatens comity on the earth. These events right now, and Doug was there. Doug, you were the lead for 7 Corps, I believe, I'm saying this correctly, and correct me, Colonel, was going to be 2nd Cavalry. Is that it?
Right. The 2nd Cavalry is shorthand for the 2nd Armored Cavalry Regiment, a force that normally was about 4,400 men, and actually during the war was reinforced to nearly 8,000. including additional attack helicopters, Apache attack helicopters, additional artillery. And the point is that this large force was designed to precede this huge 7th Corps juggernaut across southern Iraq and lead the Corps, if you will, to the Republican Guard. And we were one of the squadrons, the lead. Two ground squadrons were in the lead. There were actually three ground formations in the 2nd Cavalry, each one about 1,100 men, containing roughly 42 tanks and 42 Bradleys, along with an artillery battery of 8 guns and a host of support equipment. Each of these three squadrons were about the same in terms of their content and composition, but two were selected to lead, and we were on the left flank of the lead. We were the 2nd Squadron, known as Cougar Squadron, and we ended up being the unit that frankly encountered most of the enemy and had the opportunity to inflict serious damage on that Iraqi Republican Guard Corps when we found it.
The day of 25 February, Lieutenant General Franks gives the order to move 2nd Cavalry forward on the next day. However, there is a decision made here to lay out an enormous artillery barrage and to what you characterize, Doug, as creep forward. What does all that mean?
Well, I think we have to go back to the men who were in command at the time and to some assumptions that were made that were never changed. And assumptions are very important. You know, whenever you embark upon any military operation, you make assumptions about the enemy, assumptions about yourself, about the terrain, and so forth. And we made some assumptions in the fall of 1990, that is, the generals did, that turned out to be very inaccurate. These assumptions tended to equate the Iraqi army, which at the time, in terms of sheer numbers, was the fifth largest army in the world, with essentially a Soviet equivalent force. And there was a tendency to impute to this Iraqi army the same kind of capability and fighting power that we would have found inside the Soviet army. And this, of course, was inaccurate. And there was no willingness to look at the nature of Arab society, how Arabs think, what's important to them, and to recognize that Iraq was, in the true sense of the word, not a modern nation state in the European or Westphalian state at all. It was an artificial construct held together through force, and that the people in it had motivations somewhat different from what we would have found with the Soviet armed forces. This particular enemy force was not very competent. It was not highly trained. There were limits to its abilities and limits to its capabilities, but these things were brushed aside. And the commanding general of the Corps, General Franks, tended to insist that there was this great and dangerous and powerful enemy to our front that, to be perfectly honest, never really existed. And as a result, he tended to move against this enemy as though it were much more dangerous than it was. And what he preferred to do was to inch forward on the ground behind this devastating curtain of fire, largely from artillery and also airstrikes, in the hopes that the enemy would be largely obliterated before we actually arrived to fight him. Now, this is not a new concept. If you go back to World War I, this was very common. We used this occasionally in France and certainly later on when we entered Germany. And we did this in many cases to compensate for the fact that we had a lot of untrained people, that is, citizen soldiers, who had recently been drafted. And this was not the case in 1991. You had probably the best army that the United States has ever produced. The soldiers were extremely well trained. The equipment was certainly vastly superior to anything against it. But Franks insisted on this, and this movement was so slow and lasted so long that, to be frank, most of the enemy, this 80,000-man Republican Guard Corps, had already begun to retreat over the Euphrates, so that when we finally made contact on the 26th, we were actually fighting the rear guard that was protecting the retreat of the remaining Republican Guard.
I'm speaking to Douglas Macgregor. The book is Warrior's Rage, the Great Tank Battle of 73 Easting on 26 February. And the reason this is critical to understand is this is the battlefield that changed the Middle East, that made Saddam Hussein successful for the next years, that led to the conflict in 2003. We're going to go into action now. Cougar, attacking the rear guard. And just a taste of this, Doug, because it was the way you were all trained. That was a T-72 tank over there, and BMPs. That's the Russian vehicles. And you're shooting what to bring them down? And how did you attack them?
Well, the